I've been struggling with vacuum sweepers the last few days. I thought we would vacuum the other day, and I'd clean up, and somehow, I don't know how I did it, I got too close to Carrie's tennis shoe that was laying there, and it sucked the shoelaces up in it, and the shoe was just going boom, 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 boom. And before I could shut it off, this thing just went crazy. I could never get the beater bar to work again. I mean, the belt's still good, and I'm working on it, and I'm thinking, is there a reset button on this? What happened? And I thought, goodness gracious, you know, I don't know how to work on this. I need to bring it to Ronnie. Ronnie can fix anything. And the reason that is because Lakita fixes Ronnie. But and I thought, you know, I need to maybe take this and get it serviced. But I guess when the motor cooled off after trying to absorb a tennis shoe, this thing began to work again. And then Carrie said, you know, Matt's dog chewed up his vacuum sweeper and said it won't work because it chewed the end of it off. And, you know, no matter how hard you try to coax that vacuum sweeper, if you can't get it plugged in, how many of you know, you just got an expensive broom. That you'd be better off with the broom. And unless you get that thing connected to some energy, if you can't get it connected, you're not going to have the desired results you want. Folks, we can accomplish something if we can get connected. Why do churches, and let me just kind of go off on a real bend here. Why do churches just seem like they don't accomplish much? They can't grow. They can't reach their community. Well, one of the reasons, it is very hard for a church to remain connected. Because everybody wants their own way. I like this. I don't like that. I want to do it this way. I want to do it this way. But, you know, we have to humble ourselves down. It's not what you want. It's not what I want. But what will bring glory to God? How will God be exalted? How can we reach our neighbors, our friends, our family members? How can we go out and fulfill the Great Commission to see someone come to Jesus Christ? Well, one of the ways it happens is we have to be unified. When the early church was birthed, if you will, by the power of the Holy Spirit in Acts chapter 2, the Bible says they came together in one place, in one mind, in one accord, or we could say in one unified body, and the power of God filled those lives. So when we get together with God, something can be accomplished. The power of the Holy Spirit comes into our life. You see, we don't produce much of nothing by ourselves. You can't produce a child by yourself. You can have a great church by yourself. You can have a great business by yourself. But when we get together, we realize the power, the energy, and the possibilities. And we say, with God, all things are possible. I can live my marriage, my life, my finances at a whole new level. Because I'm hooking up with the power of God. It's beyond me. Listen, my friends, I know what I can do. The Lord told me what I can do. Without me, you can do nothing. But when I hook up with Him, when I hook up with other believers, I'm telling you, God can move in a tremendous way in all of our lives. Can I hear an amen? Take your Bible. Turn with me to Luke chapter 5. Great story. The account of Jesus going by the Sea of Galilee. Chapter 5, he is trying to teach the people. There is a throng of people there. And he sees two ships that are by the lake. And the fishermen were gone. They were out of the ship and they're washing their nets. Everybody say nets. So here they are. They're washing their nets. Jesus comes by and he says, gentlemen, could I borrow your boat for a minute? And so they say yes. They leave washing their nets, and they launch out from the shore, let's say maybe 5-10 feet. I think there's two things that happen. He gets away from the crowd. I think the acoustics are probably better, don't you? So he's standing there on the bow of the ship teaching this throng. And when he finishes teaching, he says, guys, why don't you launch out back into deep water? And he says, cast out your nets for another run. Let's see if we can catch some more fish. Now notice with me verse 4, and when he had left speaking, he said to Simon, that's Peter, launch out into the deep, let down your nets. Everybody say nets. Again, nets. One more time, nets. Let down your nets for a draught or drag, and let's see if we can catch some fish. Now, if you have your Bible, I've got it in parentheses in my Bible, or underline the word nets. Now, the word nets is plural. Everybody say plural. Now, Peter said to him, he said, Master, we've been fishing all night, and we've taken nothing. I mean, there's nothing out there. Nevertheless, at your word, I will let down the net. Now, everybody say net. Now, notice what Jesus said. He said, let down your nets, plural. But Peter let down how many nets? One. Wow. Jesus said, let down your nets. So evidently, he only took one down from the repair and drying, put it back into the boat, went out to the deep. But that wasn't what Jesus said. When I thought about this, we were talking about this last week. Remember at the marriage of Canaan? And Mary comes to Jesus, said they've ran out of wine. Can you help them? And then Mary turns to the people who are over the wedding, and this is what she says. Whatever he says to do, do it. Why did she say that? How many of you believe she had some history with him? She raised him from birth, right? I mean, Mary gives the Immaculate Conception. The Virgin Mary gives the birth to Jesus. And she watches her baby boy grow up to age 30 before he begins his ministry. Now, the Bible's really silent, but could you imagine that Mary saw some stuff from the time he's an infant to the time he's 30? And let's say his rebellious teenage years, and he wasn't rebellious, he's without sin, but maybe as his father's building the chair in the carpentry shop, he sits over there and just says, chair. And Joseph says, now stop that, Jesus. It's not how we're building chairs here. So Mary says to the wedding party, whatever he says do, do it. But Peter didn't, did he? Jesus said, let down your nets, plural. Peter just gets one net. But notice when they go out to fish, when they're bringing in the net, there is so many fish in the net begins to break. But if they had had nets, plural, they could have contained more fish. But notice what the Word of God says. Notice in verse 7, and they beckoned, they cried out to their partners, which were in other ships, that they should come and help them, and they came and filled both ships, that they began to sink. Do you catch something here? To catch more fish, you got to call out to your what? Partners. How many of you want to catch more fish? I don't care if it's natural or spiritual. Man, I want to catch more fish. Jesus tells this crew, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. The Bible says they left their boats, they left their nets, they followed him. They began to catch men instead of fish. But Peter didn't really do what Jesus said. But I believe the next time they went fishing, if Jesus says, hey, throw out your nets, how many of you believe he brought more than one net the next time? Absolutely. Because, see, he didn't have that history. He didn't link up like he should have linked up. Folks, he had to call his partners. I think one of the points here is we catch more fish when we partner together. But there's always the Lone Rangers, isn't there? Lone Wolf, McQuaid. What is that his name? There's always those people. Well, I'm going to do it on my own. Oh, really? You know what they're going to do? They're going to go from church to church. They're going to go from pulpit to pulpit, engagement to engagement. They're going to preach here. They're going to preach there. And they will never have the catch. Listen to me. They will never have the catch. unless they partner together with like-minded believers to fulfill the commission of God. It's the power of association. Do you know there are things that other people do that's better than you? I'm preaching better than what you think. There is power in association. We have to look to see there is partnership here with Peter and the rest of the crowd. They teamed up to get the catch. You see, if we can only hold so much, then let's pull our resources. Let's pull our boats together, if you will, and let's see God work among us. Listen, Ray of Hope can be at another level. But it takes all of us to get there. Unless you say, well, you don't need me. Oh, yes, we do. We're diminished without you. We're not as much without you. We can't catch as much fish without you. You bring something to the table that I don't have, that other people don't have. We have to have you. But if you've got to go do your thing, if you've got to go out on your little trip to catch your one fish with your one net, then God bless you. But I'd rather say, hey, partners, let's throw out so many nets here. Let's just catch as many as we can. Amen. Man, how many of you know God wants us to catch some fish? Problem with some of us, we want to clean them before we catch them, don't we? That's another sermon. Say, move on, preacher. You know how Jesus began his ministry? Think about this. Jesus began his ministry by picking his partners. Jesus began his ministry by picking his partners. Now, why? Because number one, he had to give his influence, his environment to them. Secondly, he knew he wasn't always going to be with them. Let me tell you about the power of partnership, the power of association. I believe that our church, the one that we're all a part of, we need to reach people of all ages. We need to connect with people who are 60, 70, 80, 90 years old. We need to try to reach people who are 3, 5, 12, 16, 18. Young families who have children. How many of you know our mentality should be we need to connect, we need to associate with all ages, all types of people. Why? Because everybody brings something different to the table.